Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Dennis Prager Show. Hi, everybody. I'm going to go straight to my guest. For the vast majority of you, he needs no introduction. Alan Dershowitz, best-selling author, emeritus professor of law, Harvard University, one of the best-known lawyers in the United States as well. And I might add, without embarrassing him, that he has the trait that I most value in humans, courage. And it's come to express itself once more in his outcry with regard to Paul Manafort. Alan Dershowitz, I want to tell you something. I opened the show today saying something I may have said in 35 years of broadcasting, maybe once and very possibly never. The treatment of Paul Manafort, whom I don't know, never met, the treatment of him, solitary confinement, and now, as you point out, sent to this horrible hellhole called Rikers Island, is one of the few times that I am actually, I feel that America is embarrassing me. I feel that I feel embarrassed. And it was a painful thing for me to say because I love this country. So why don't you react?
Well, I'm not embarrassed for America. I'm embarrassed for the Mueller people. I'm embarrassed for the District Attorney of New York. I'm embarrassed for anyone who allowed this to happen. What's happened to Manafort is exactly what Stalin and Beria conversed when Beria said to Stalin, show me the man and I'll find you the crime. Even Judge Ellis, who presided over the Manafort trial and sentenced him, said, look, they're not interested in Manafort or any bank fraud. They're only interested in squeezing him to get him to sing against President Trump. And sometimes when people are squeezed, they not only sing, they compose. And I think they're sending him to Rikers in order to get him to sing, in order to get him to come up with evidence that the district attorney or the attorney general of New York would use to try to prosecute Donald Trump. Because remember, the law is not clear whether a sitting president can or cannot be prosecuted for a state crime. We know he can't be pardoned or pardon anybody for a state crime. But can he be prosecuted for a state crime? We don't know the answer to that, but we do know that there's pressure on New York prosecutors to try to come up with anything they can against Trump, not because they believe he's committed crimes, because they don't like him as president, and they're afraid that they don't have the ability to defeat him at the polls, so they want to defeat him in the courts of law. They want to weaponize the criminal justice system, which is a danger to all Americans, and every civil libertarian should be concerned. And if this were not Donald Trump, the Civil Liberties Union would be concerned. Total silence from them, total silence from them on virtually every civil liberties issue these days. But it's an absolute outrage.
Just review, if you would. I did, but I want them to hear it from you. How he has been treated.
Well, first he was denied bail for no good reason. They could easily have allowed him to stay out. They put him in solitary. Obviously, the goal was to try to get him to flip. That didn't work. So then they tried him twice. That has apparently not worked. Now they're going to move him to one of the worst prisons in the world, Rikers Island, which is one of the most dangerous spots on earth. I've had to go there from time to time to visit clients, mostly very violent criminals, murderers, and people of that kind. It's rare you find a white-collar presumed innocent defendant. Remember, he's still presumed innocent with the state charges, and he's never been denied bail in the state charges. And yet, in effect, without a judicial determination, he's being sent to Rikers Island to continue to serve his federal sentence, which is supposed to be at a reasonable facility in Pennsylvania where he has been serving it.
Why was he put in solitary confinement in the federal prison?
Oh, I think just to put pressure on him. There was
Wait. Who's they? This is what's not clear to me. Who put him in solitary?
The prosecutors in the case, Mueller and also other prosecutors, they have the authority to at least recommend it. They don't have the authority to do it. It's up to the department and the Bureau of Prisons, but they will usually follow these kinds of recommendations. But it's really unheard of. What they do is they put high-profile people in solitary. They claim for their own protection, which is an acknowledgement that just keeping him in prison poses a danger to him because there are going to be some anti-Trump people in prison. There are going to be some anti-famous people in prison, and so they're going to have to put him in solitary. But courts have over and over again ruled that solitary confinement is cruel and unusual punishment, except in the most extreme circumstances. And certainly lengthy solitary is cruel and unusual, and there's no reason to do it. Let's assume he's going to be tried in New York in 6 months. So what they do is they keep him in the federal prison. He's not going anywhere. And then a week before or 3 days before he's to be tried in New York, you bring him to New York and put him in the federal detention facility because he's under federal sentence, not the state detention facility. But even if you put him in the state detention facility, keep him there only during the trial. We don't even have a date scheduled for the trial, so he could stay in Rikers now for a year.
You write that Cyrus Vance, the prosecutor there, is he the district attorney? What is his position?
He's the district attorney, the elected
district attorney.
All right,
you wrote a decent man, and I said on the air, okay, I said that you cannot be decent and do this at the same time.
Well, that's a point. I mean, when I say a decent man, I know him, I've spoken to him, he's charitable, he speaks at lots of police athletic league events. He's a nice guy. His father was the Secretary of the State under Jimmy Carter. This is an indecent thing. I agree with you. And if you define a person's decency by the actions he takes, then I think your point has to be given credence.
What I don't understand, what are his lawyers doing? I mean, are they effective? If you were his lawyer, what would you do?
Well, it's very hard to be a lawyer involving people's imprisonment. Those are very administrative, and it's like punching a Jell-O bowl. It's very hard to find the right people. I would, of course, take the case to court immediately. I would take it first to the sentencing judge, Ellis, and say, look, you sentenced him to prison in federal prison, and they're circumventing your order by taking him and putting him in a state hellhole. There's no reason or justification for that. Look, I will try every legal recourse available, and he should do that. The other thing the president could do, if he chose to, I don't know if he will, is immediately pardon him. And if he were immediately pardoned, he'd be freed from all imprisonment, and then the state would have to seek his imprisonment and seek to deny him bail. And that might be a difficult thing to do, because even in the state courts, people are not denied bail for mortgage-related crimes. So that's one possible remedy. The president could pardon him for federal crimes. He then gets released. He then gets extradited to New York, where he has the right to challenge the bail.
Oh, that's very important, then. I think I wonder if this is... And the president, all the president needs to say is, my fellow Americans, what is being done to this man reminds me, in Professor Alan Dershowitz's words, of what Stalin and Beria did. We're not going to do this in America, so I am pardoning his crimes, which I would not have done otherwise, but I want to save this man's life. What do they want? I'm sorry, go on.
That would be a plausible response to this outrageous action by prosecutors. The president's role is... presidents don't understand this often. I think Donald Trump understands this. The pardon power is part of our systems of checks and balances. The president's ability to pardon is a check on the excesses of the judiciary, mm-hmm. to harsh sentences. Mm-hmm. It's also a check on prosecutors. It's also a check on state action. And this president, I think, understands the systemic role that pardon plays in our system of checks and balances. And I think it would be a good thing if he exercised that more often. And pardon shouldn't be reserved only for extraordinary cases. Pardon should be seen as part of our system and an important part of our system, especially because sentences are so outrageously out of whack. You know that a zero has been added to sentences since I started practicing 50 years ago. For crimes that people used to get one, they get 10, two, they get 20, three, they get 30. A zero has been added. And, some people might say that's a good thing, but this president has not. He has introduced legislation that was passed by both houses and signed by him, releasing people who have served overlong sentences. So I think he's sensitive to the issue of how the judiciary can go too far, and the legislature, because the legislature is the one that proposes the sentencing guidelines and the sentences. So the pardon is a check both on the legislature and on the judiciary, and I think it's important to understand the systematic role it plays in our constitutional balance.
And I remind you that he's a Democrat, a liberal, and a Hillary Clinton supporter.